Well, we welcome you to this broadcast of Lovedale Ministries outside Stilfontein in the northwest of South Africa. Man, I'm going to bring you a message today on restoration. I think that the devil has stolen enough of the church. He's destroyed enough in your life. And get ready, God is going to touch you with a miracle. And everything that's been stolen of you, God's going to bring it back to you at least double. So get ready, get your Bible, tell your friends, glory. Right.
God wil nie vir jou die R500 gee om jou water en ligte te betaal nie. Hy wil vir jou die 1000 gee sodat jy iemand anders dan ook kan betaal. God wil jou nie net gesond maak nie, hy wil jou touch sodat jy jou hande op siekes kan lê en hulle ook gesond kan word.
Yeah. Yeah. I said our God is unlimited. I said our God is unlimited. Jeremia sê, ek is die God van alle vlees. Sou enige iets vir my te wonderbaar wees? Is there anything too difficult, too hard, or too great for God to do in your life? Is there anything too difficult for God to do in your life?
We will stand back and let you move. Stand back and let you move. We will stand back and see what you will.
Here sê, dis 'n deurbraak wat ek vir jou wil gee. En in hierdie deurbraak sal jy mure van weerstand uit die pad uit kan vee. My heerlikheid en my krag sal ek in jou midde inbring. Wanneer jy vol van vreugde my lof besing. En dit wat ek begin het, sal ek in jou lewe volbring. Ek is 'n God van lewe en van oorvloed. En as ek dinge doen, doen ek dit met 'n spoed. Waarom sal jy wonder en angstig rondkyk? Dis van al die rondkyk wat jou gesig al so lyk. Dis tyd om opgewonde en bly te raak. Want God sê, as jy stil voor my raak, sal jy weet, hierdie geveg is my saak. En sodoende sal jy in hierdie deurbraak in kan stap. En God sê, vat 'n nuwe kleed. Moenie die ou ding probeer lap. Nuwe wyn stort ek in jou midde. In, jy moet van vreugde my lof kan sing. So die deurbraak is joune in hierdie dag. Vat dit, hoekom wil jy langer wag?
Praise Him, 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 yeah, 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 praise Him, praise Him, praise Him, praise Him, praise Him, praise Him, yeah, yeah.
Wie sukkel met 'n ding in sy linkerbeen? So brandsituasie in jou linkerbeen.
Staan op, Here, by jou genees. Sit jy hom, wat gaat aan met die ding? Brand hy? Ja, ek het hom gesien. Staan maar daar voor, Here, gee nou gezond maak. Bless you, Jesus. Fiet begin probleme ontwikkel met jou prostaat. Staan op, oomie, broer. Staan op, die Here wie jou vandag genees. Jy besef daar as probleme, gaan staan daar voor. Wie gebruik sindels of het uit die mode uitraak? Staan daar voor, God gee jou gezond maak. Ek sien sindels. Ek sien die naam. Dis wat jy drink. Jy hoef het nie meer te drink nie. God gee jou vandag genees van enige ding wat vir jou pyn gee. Wil jy grandpa moet ook al voor gaan staan. Ek is ernstig. Sien hy poeierkies hoe oopvou. Gooi het op jou tong en slik hy goed. Die Here gaan jou gezond maak. Kom stap uit. Maar daar is drie van die dames hier so wat al drie geweldig sukkel met blaasprobleme. Gou daarvoor. Die ander ene wat nie daarvoor is nie, jy het blaas en dik darm probleme as jy dan wil weet. Kan jy glo, die 17 mense wat vandag so gespanne was terwyl ons hier besig was, en nou dat jy gaan sit, besef jy, my goodness, maar ek voel goed. Net as 'n bewys, toets jouself en dan staan jy op as jy besef, my goodness, ek was so opgestres en nou voel ek dan regtig really relax. Staan gou op. 17 mense. Liewe Vader, ek dank U. Kom ons gee God eer terwyl ons die Here eer, is die rustigheid van die Here besig om oor te val. Ek wil net hê baie dankie julle kan sit. Ek wil net hê jy moet ervaar dat God is besig om hier so 'n miracle te doen. Bless you, Jesus. Is julle reg vir 'n miracle? Bless you, Jesus. Bless you, Jesus. Steek op aan hom, Kas. Waar is die brand? Hy sê die brand is weg.
Yes, halleluja.
Touch hom, Here. Hey! Wat van julle drie vat hande? Staan daar drie mense achter julle. Terwyl julle hande vat, steek julle op. Ok, allemaal in die gehoor sê, maak hulle gezond.
Yes.
Soos in nou,
yes.
In Jesus naam. Dankie, Here. Bless hulle. Here, laat hulle vry is. Nooit weer te sukkel nie. In Jesus naam. It's your right, my vrou. Geef hom in die hart. Geef hom in die hart. In Jesus naam. Verlos hom van pyn en van sindels. In die naam van die Here. Verlos hom van pyn, sindels en poeiers en goeders. Dankie, Here. Ah, bless hom. Wat dink jy, hoe moet kerk wees?
Lekker.
Ek vraag my nou so net die vraag, terwyl ek nou hier rondloop en penne kry en die mense hier sit, hoor ek net, hoe dink jy moet kerk wees? Een georganiseerde klub, wat jy weet, die spel begin 10:00 en 11:00 is die spel verby. En ek betaal my maandelikse fooie, en as die spel te lang hou, gaan ek nie weer, kan daar kyk nie, dan gaan ek een ander klap soek. Kerk is nie dit wat vanavond begin, en oor een uur ophou nie. Kerk is een levenswyse verhouding met die Here Jesus Christus. 24 hours a day. En ek kom nie by die huis en sê, my vrou sal ons nader sit en boeke vat. Seuns, sit nou stil, ons gaan nou saam lees, en wel opgeteken in Exodus, en ons vind dit wel in hoofstuk 24. Hey, as ons Bybel lees, dan sit ons daar, party sit op die grond, party sit op die mat, party sit op die stoel, en ons praat oor die wonderlike dinge van die Here. Kerk is lewe, mense. Besef jy, dat God het mense vrede gegee, hy het mense gezond gemaak, hy is geblest deur ons aanbidding,
Psalm 137 and Psalm 126. We're just going to read a few verses and see what the word of the Lord says. Go for it.
By the rivers of Babylon, there we sat down and wept.
Listen, listen. By the rivers of Babylon means they were in captivity in Babylon. You remember the captivity that the people of Israel were in for 70 years. And by the rivers, listen to this, by the rivers of Babylon, the people sat and they wept when they remembered. Right, go, Peter.
When we remembered Zion.
Yeah.
Upon the willows, in the midst of it, we hung our hearts.
Right. And while they were remembering Zion, they took the willow trees. And they hang their harps on the willow trees. The angle harpies, okay.
For there our captors demanded of us songs.
They demanded of us songs.
And our tormentors mirth, saying, sing us one of the songs of Zion. How can we sing the Lord's song?
How can we sing? We can not sing. Right?
How can we sing the Lord's song in a foreign land? If I forget.
Right, that's it. Listen, by the rivers of Babylon, while they were taken away in captivity, they were sitting and they were weeping and they remembered the good old days and they took their harps and they hung it upon the willow trees and they could not sing. No singing, no rejoicing. Psalm 126.
When the Lord brought back the captivity of Zion.
Right, when God turned the captivity. Here they were in captivity, here God changed the captivity. Right.
We were like those who dream. Then our mouth was filled with laughter.
Oh my goodness. Their mouths were filled with laughter.
And our tongue with singing.
Oh, and they were singing.
Then they said to the nations, the Lord has done great things for them. The Lord has done great things for us. And we are glad.
Oh, they were glad. Listen, I want you to shout and preach with me today. There are two psalms, and both talked about the captivity of the people of Israel. In the one psalm, they were sitting by the rivers, and they were weeping as they remembered Zion by the rivers of Babylon. There we sat down and there we wept and we remembered Zion. You're laughing. This is a condition of most Christians. They forever weeping and forever groaning and moaning and complaining about how it used to be and how it was and how good it was, how the good old days. Oh, and I wish I lived in the days of Jesus. Oh, I wish that. These are the days of Jesus.
Amen.
But in Psalm 126, God changed the captivity, and instead of weeping, there were laughter. Instead of not singing, they were singing. Instead of mourning, they were glad. So I want you to make a choice tonight in this house and all over these airwaves, you looking by TV. I want you to make a choice right in your house. Which psalm do you want to live in? Can I hear you shout it out? Which psalm do you want to spend your life in?
126.
Shout it again.
126.
Yeah. Psalm 126. Just read Ezekiel chapter 1 verse 1 for us. Listen to Ezekiel chapter 1 and verse 1. I tell you, man, God is going to bless us tonight. He's going to change our captivity. He's going to turn it round and about. And we're going to get from God. And we're not going to lose anymore. Ezekiel chapter 1. Echelon, verse 1.
Now it came about in the 30th year, on the fifth day of the fourth month, while I was by the river Chebar.
Listen, the captivity were 40 years long. And this was in the
30th year
of the captivity.
On the fifth day of the fourth month, while I was by the river Chebar.
While I was at the
river.
Is there somebody in this house tonight? Listen. In the 30th year, they were sitting by the rivers. They were weeping. When they remembered Zion, they hung their harps on the willow trees and they could not sing. But in the same time, at the same river, Ezekiel was sitting. At the same river. And look what happened to him.
Among the exiles. The heaven.
Among the exiles. So he was one of the people that were sitting in Babylon in captivity. Read, Peter.
The heavens were open.
The heavens were open.
And I saw visions.
I saw visions of God. Come on, people. In the midst of persecution, in the midst of captivity, at the same river where people were sitting weeping when they remembered Zion and they could not sing, at the same river there was Ezekiel with heavens opened above him, and he saw visions of the great eternal God, and the Spirit of the Lord lifted him up and took him to a valley and put him amongst a lot of dry bones and said, Ezekiel, can these dry bones live? And he said, Lord, thou knowest. And he said, Ezekiel, prophesied to these dry bones, and he prophesied, and there stood up a great and mighty army. Revival! Hier is toe was my oupa grootjie sin. This chair belonged to my oupa grootjie. To my great great grandfather. This chair belonged to my great-great-grandfather. At a time, they painted it yellow. Then my grandmother got it, and she didn't like it yellow. She made it green. Then my mother got it, so he said after, and she decided she'd like it red, so she painted it red. Then I got it and I decided I don't like it red, green, or yellow. I'm going to restore it. But in the meantime, the one leg broke off and I was geen riempies. So I took it home and I started scratching all the paint off, got some paint stripper, cleaned the thing, brushed it off. Man, oh man, and I saw, goodness, look at this yellow wood. Look at this lovely wood. Wat het die ou mense aangevang om die ding te paint? So I got some wood glue, put the leg back, restored it. And then somebody else who had a great-great-grandfather that was still alive came to my house. And he said, my goodness, I love the way you restored this chair. It looks exactly like it used to look. I can remember those days. Man, this thing is restored to its normal, original form. You did a good work in restoring this chair. And God spoke to me and said, because of our ideas of restoration, we're missing the plan of the Most High God. Because we think restoration is bringing it back to its normal state, to its original state. But when God restores, he says it's not going to be the same. It's going to be more than what you ever had. Come on, church, in the book of Haggai chapter 2, the Bible declares, who is there that can remember the former glory of this house? Behold, saith the Lord, the latter glory of this house will be much greater than the former glory. So God says, if I bring restoration, it'll be better than anything you ever saw or ever had. Can somebody say, yes, Lord, we want that restoration. So God's going to bring restoration more than anything you ever had. Say it out loud. Restoration. More than before. Come on. Say it to somebody next to you. Say, if God restores, it's more than before. If God restores, it's more than before. Exodus chapter 22. Get yourself ready to get out of everything that's wrong. Bless you, Jesus. Exodus and chapter 22. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If a man steals an ox, you can read it in any translation you've got in front of you. If a man steals an ox or a sheep and slaughters it or sells it, he shall restore 5 oxen for an ox and 4 sheep for a sheep. Listen closely and take note. If anyone steals from you an ox, he must restore 5 times. If anybody steals a sheep, he must restore 4-fold. Verse 4. If the theft is certainly found alive in his hand, whether it has an ox or donkey or sheep, he shall restore double. Verse 7. If a man delivers to his neighbor money or articles to keep, and it is stolen out of the man's house, if the thief is found, he shall pay double. Got it right this time. Verse 9. For any kind of trespass, whether it concerns an ox, a donkey, a sheep, or clothing, or for any kind of loss which another claims to be, any kind of loss. Just say any kind of loss. Whomever the judges condemn shall pay double to his neighbor. Any losses, at least double. So listen, church, and take note in this night. I don't know what has been stolen from you. I don't know what has been taken away from you. I don't know what promises you had from God and yet not have received it. I don't know. And if nothing has been stolen from you, if nothing has been stripped away from you, still, if we go to the Word of God and see all the promises in this book, I can guarantee you there's not one single person in this house tonight. I don't even think there's one person listening to my voice tonight that can agree. There's not one person that I know that live in the total blessings of Deuteronomy 28 that God has said his church must have. Blessed in the city, blessed in the field. Blessed going out, blessed coming in. Blessed standing up, blessed going to bed. Blessed in the morning, blessed in the evening. Blessed in the city, blessed in the field. Blessed in everything you touch. Come on, people. I want you to know God has promised that you will be blessed in everything. You will always be able to just give out money and you will never have to go ask for money. So if you do not live in the total blessings, you've been robbed. Listen, if you do not live in the total blessings of God, you've been robbed. So, you can expect 5 times more, 4 times more, but at least double of anything that God has ever promised you or you ever lost. Go to the book of Luke, chapter 19. Bless you, Jesus. Luke chapter 19. Then Jesus entered and passed through Jericho. Now behold, there was a man named Zacchaeus, who was a chief tax collector, and he was rich. Now I've got to say this in Afrikaans because I don't know the English version. Maar Zacchaeus was a man, en a klein man. A baie klein man was hy. Hy klim toe op in die willevye boom om die meester te kan sien. En toe die meester daar verby kom, kyk hy op en sê, Zacchaeus, klim af, ek gaan na jou huis vandag. Ek gaan na jou huis vandag. And that's where the story of Zacchaeus ends in our theology. He was a small man who climbed up a sycamore tree, and Jesus had to get him down to go to his house. And because We have belittled the Word of God and made Sunday school stories out of it. We miss the truth that God is trying to tell us. And I tell you, the revelations in the story of Zacchaeus is so great. Amen. It'll turn your motor on tonight.
Amen.
Verse 8. So Jesus went with Zacchaeus. Then Zacchaeus stood and said to the Lord, "Look, Lord, I give half of my goods to the poor. And if I have taken anything from anyone by false accusation, I restore fourfold." So what's happening? Zacchaeus knew the principle that God laid down for his people. If anything is taken from anybody, it must be restored five, four, or twofold. So here, Zacchaeus meets the Creator, the Lawgiver, the one that came and finished the law and brought a New Testament to us. And Zacchaeus stands face to face with the King of Glory. A revelation hits him. This is the man who is the Deliverer, the Redeemer, the Restorer. So I better know what to tell him. Jesus, if I have taken anything from anybody, I restore fourfold. Listen, 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 listen. And Jesus said to him, "Today salvation has come to this house." He didn't confess Jesus. He didn't accept Jesus. He just confessed the principle that he knew was in the Word. He said, "Lord, if I have taken anything, I will restore it fourfold." Jesus said, "My goodness, salvation has come to this house." Verse 10, "For the Son of Man has come to seek and save that which was lost." Somebody say glory. I want to explain this to you. If anything has been stolen from you, it will be restored fivefold, fourfold, or at least double. Zacchaeus stands before Jesus and says, "Jesus, if I have taken anything from anybody, I restore fourfold." Jesus stood back and said, "Today salvation has come to this house. For I, standing in front of you, am the Son of God, and I have come to seek and save that which was lost." He did not say, "I have come to seek and save those which were lost." Then those are John 3:16. "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life." That is the salvation scripture. This is not a scripture for that type of salvation. This is a scripture for what's been stolen and taken away will be restored to you. When Zacchaeus talked about restoration fourfold, Jesus said, "My goodness, man, salvation has come to your house." What type of salvation is coming to your house, Zacchaeus? The Son of Man is come to seek what the devil has stolen throughout all these years. The Son of Man is come to seek it. Then he's going to find it. And then he's going to restore it. For the Son of Man is come to seek and to save that which was lost. What was lost? All the blessings of God. Come on, the children of Israel never lived in the blessings of God. Here and there somebody got the blessings, but the Bible declares they could not get it because of the law. Amen. And because they sinned, the law stood against them, so they could never get the blessings. So Jesus said, "I have come to seek those blessings that I have promised to Abraham. And if I'm going to find it, I'm going to save it back from the hands of Satan.
Thank you, Lord.
I'm going to seek those blessings. And I'm going to save it out of the hands of Satan. I'm going to seek those blessings. The Son of Man has come to seek and to save it." Listen to John 10:10. You may have heard it many times before, but I want you to hear it like you've never heard it before. "The thief cometh not," or "only," depends on which translation you've got in front of you. the thief. And we read a lot about the thief in Exodus 22. The thief cometh only to steal, to kill, and to destroy. But I, the Son of God, has come.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
To seek and save that which was lost. But here I have come that you might have life. That you might have life abundantly. That you might, you can go look in your translations, that you might have life more. Come on, somebody, abundantly. Glory. Whatever has been stolen, killed, or destroyed in your life, I have come to seek it. And after I found it, I'm going to save it. And then I'm going to give it to you more abundantly. Then he has come to give it back to you so that you might have this life that's been stolen more abundantly. That means you're going to have fivefold, fourfold, at least double. Hallelujah. And we take it today in the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of the Most High God. Job. Go to the book of Job. I don't know about you, but I want to hear this word another time. I want to hear it another time. I've just realized that too much have been stolen from us. Hey, church. Elijah was this mighty prophet. Performed all these mighty miracles. But when somebody had to follow him up by the name of Elisha, Elisha realized what Elijah had would not carry it through. And what did he ask for? At least double. And what did he get? A double portion. So I don't care what Paul had. I don't care what Peter had. I don't care what Smith Wigglesworth had. I don't care what Catherine Kuhlman had. I look at it as an inspiration. But I'm standing in the year 2000. 2 millenniums after Christ. I want at least double of anything that ever happened. Because what they had will not make it today. Because it was a total different age they lived in. And where the Bible says go into all the world, that word world in the original means go into your generation and preach the gospel to all your generation. Just for interesting sake, the scholars watching by TV, go check it out. Go into all your generation and preach the gospel to your generation. Because 100 years ago, that generation would not have listened to me. Come on, people. If you must go back in history and all of a sudden you wake up 300 years ago and all you see is horses and swords and Anna greep jou sanna. Dis die Afrikaanse film van Annie get your gun. Okay. Sê nou net. Die goed is, moet begin. Jy moet teruggeplaas word in daai tyd. You would not have made it. It's all right to look at all these faith heroes, and we got to look at them. I love to look at their lives. But I tell you, if you go get Wesley and put him in the year 2000, he will not make it. Because God raised him up for his generation. That was a total different generation. So we don't need what Wesley had. We don't need what Finney had. We don't need what Paul and Silas and Peter had. We need at least double what they had, because it's another day and it's another age. We need a greater anointing. Job chapter 1. There was a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job. And that man was blameless and upright, and one who feared God and shunned evil. 7 sons. Let's get it again. 7 sons.
3 daughters.
3 daughters.
Also his possessions were 7,000
sheep. 7,000
sheepies. 3,000 camels.
3,000 camels.
500 yoke of oxen.
500 yoke of oxen.
500 female donkeys.
500 donkeys. And the Bible says, and a very large household, so that this man was the greatest of all the people in the east. Verse 13. Now there was a day when the sons and daughters were eating and drinking. Remember, Satan then came and asked to destroy him. A messenger came to Job and said, the oxen were plowing and the donkeys feeding beside them when the Sabaeans raided them and took them away. Indeed, they have killed the servants with the edge of the sword. I alone have escaped to tell you. While he was still speaking, another also came and said, the fire of God fell from heaven and burned up the sheep and the servants and consumed them. And I alone have escaped to tell you. While he was still speaking, another also came and said, the Chaldeans formed 3 bands, raided the camels and took them away. Yes, and killed the servants with the edge of the sword. And I alone have escaped to tell you. While he was still speaking, another also came and said, your sons and daughters were eating and drinking wine in the oldest brother's house. And suddenly a great wind came across the wilderness and struck the 4 corners of the house and fell on the young people, and they are dead. And I alone have escaped to tell you. Then Job arose, tore his robe and shaved his head and fell to the ground and worshipped and said, naked I came from my mother's womb. Naked shall I return there. The Lord gave and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. In all this, Job did not sin nor charge God with wrong. So we know the rest of the story. Job lost it all. It was stolen, killed, destroyed, and he sat on the ash heap outside the city, scraping himself, and dogs came and licked his wounds. Yeah. Yeah. Come on, church. That is some situation to sit in. From the richest, greatest man in the east to the poorest, most miserable man in the east. From the highest place of glory to the lowest place of defeat. Yeah. What a shape for Job to sit in. 42. Job 42. Thank you, Lord, for open ears to hear. Amen. Receptive hearts to receive. Job 42. I'd love for us to shout right now. Verse 10 says, and the Lord restored.
Yes, hallelujah.
And the Lord restored. And the Lord restored. God is not in the taking away business. God is not in the killing, destroying, destructive business. God is in the restoring business. And the Lord restored Job's losses when he prayed for his friends. Indeed, the Lord gave Job, what does your Bible say? Twice, double, Afrikaans, double. That is the least you can get back. What does your health look like tonight? God never said you will die when you're sick. God said that the years of man are 120 years, and he didn't mention sickness. The Bible declares in Deuteronomy 34 that Moses was 120 years old. His eyes didn't grow dim and his strength didn't diminish. And at 120 years of age, he climbed the mountain and God just took him. No sickness, no pain, no disease. So what has been stolen of you? Your hearing? The use of all your muscles? Eyesight, what have been stolen? God says, hey, I'm going to restore. And God restored Job twice as much as he had before. At least double. Yeah. Verse number 12. Now you must listen. Peter will read it for us.
And the Lord.
You're going to look at the board while Peter read it. The Lord
blessed the latter days of Job more than his beginning. And he had 14,000.
Oh!
And 6,000 camels.
Oh!
And 1,000 yoke.
Oh!
And 1,000 feet.
Oh! The Lord restores! Oh! Glory! Glory! Come on, shout somebody! At least double! There it is in your Bible. In Exodus 20, if something has been stolen, killed, or destroyed, God's going to restore it fivefold, fourfold, but at least double. Jesus called Zacchaeus out of the tree, and he said, Lord, if I've taken away anything, I will give fourfold back. Jesus said, salvation has come because the Son of Man has come to seek and save that which was lost. Because I have come, where what the thief has stolen, killed, and destroyed, I have come that you might have it more abundantly. Because I have come to seek and save that which was lost. Because I have come that you might have it more abundantly. So when Job lost everything, God restored it, and he had, instead of 7,000, 14,000, 3,000, 6,000, 500, 1,000, 500, hey! Read verse 16, Peter. 16.
And after this, Job lived 140 years.
Oh, goodness. Listen. He lived another 140 years. My goodness. And over here, after your 40. Lived another 140 years.
And saw his sons and his grandsons, four generations.
Oh, so papa, opa, grootjie, en groot grootjie. Ek weet nie of ek my kleinkinders ooit gaan sien. So kyk hoe die land nou lyk. Waar, look at the situation this country's in. If I look around me, I don't know if I'll ever see my grandchildren. Now I'm going to see my great, 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 great grandchildren. Why? Because I'm expecting God to restore what's been stolen, what's been killed, what's been destroyed. But something had to happen to Job. So let's go to Job chapter 8. Remember where we started this message? We started with Psalm 137 and Psalm 126. And we said here they were weeping, there they were laughing. There they were in captivity. There God changed their captivity. And what did Job chapter 42 verse 10 said? God changed or turned the captivity of Job. Yes, and restored, and he got at least double. And we saw it. Right. Now Job chapter 8. Job chapter 8 verse 5. If you would earnestly seek God and make your supplication to the Almighty, if you were pure and upright, surely now He would awake for you and prosper your rightful dwelling place. God will prosper you. Though your beginning was small, yet your latter end would increase abundantly. That was right when Job started losing his possessions. When the thief started killing, stealing, and destroying, he had a prophetic word that said, Job, although your beginning was small, your latter days will be much greater. Amen. Job, I don't care how insignificant everything looks around you. Remember, God is a God of restoration, and you're going to get back at least double. Verse 19. Behold, this is the joy of his way, and out of the earth others will grow. That others is out of the earth, God will restore what's been destroyed. Behold, God will not cast away the blameless, nor will he uphold the evildoers. He will yet fill your mouth with laughing and your lips with rejoicing. Psalm 26, when God turned the captivity of Zion, their mouths were filled with laughter and their lips with rejoicing. When God prophesied over Job's life, he said, Job, although it seems so small in your life now that you've lost everything, I'm going to restore you. Then your mouth will be filled with laughter and your lips with rejoicing. So God is saying, Job, I will turn your captivity. And then all the evildoers will be clothed with shame. And the place of the enemy, in your Bible, the next verse, and the place of the enemy shall not be found.
Yes.
I want you to know this. The place of the enemy shall not be found. Jesus came, and listen what he said to the disciples. He said, Satan cometh, but he's got no place in me. Listen, Jesus said to the disciples, Satan is coming, but he's got no place in me. Jesus says, if I turn your captivity, if I bring restoration, the devil will have no more place in your life.
That's it.
When restoration hits, there will be no more foothold for Satan. If God starts restoring, if God starts blessing, the devil won't be able to get in again. I want to repeat it. Because if I look at the lives of people, if I look over this audience, I can see and I can witness and I can testify how people have been robbed, how things have been stolen, how they've been misused and abused. You agree? Just look at your life. So what does that mean? It means Satan got a foothold somewhere, because he's the one that's stealing and robbing and killing and destroying. But the word of the Lord says, if God turns your captivity, if God starts restoring, you will fill your mouth with laughter, your lips with rejoicing, and the place of the enemy shall not be found. So when God starts restoring, the devil won't be able to get in again. Shout, yeah. The devil will not be able to get in again. In restoration, no more devil.
Thank you, Lord.
So instead of struggling to get delivered, get restoration.
Yes.
Listen to what I'm saying. Instead of struggling for deliverance, get restoration. Because if restoration hits your house, there will be no more devils. Because if Satan sees, my goodness, look at this man, all he receives is blessings, he will know that his time is up. How will he know it? Your mouth will be filled with laughter and your lips with rejoicing.
Yeah, but I don't know. I don't know either about you.
But I know about me. I will not be ashamed of the gospel. I will stand up here and shout the praises of God. And I will shout unto God. And I will give him the praise. Because my lips are filled with rejoicing, because I can see restoration coming. Let's finish this thing with Joel. My. No deliverance, restoration. Restoration, no more devils. So instead of trying to get devils out of you, let's try and get each other restored. For these are the days of Elijah. Restoring the word of the Lord. These are the days of your servant Moses, restoring the word of God. These are the days of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming as flesh. These are the days of your servant David, rebuilding the temple of praise. I tell you, God says, and then I will come and rebuild the temple or the tabernacle of David. We're living in the days of restoration. Acts chapter 3, verse 19 through 21 says, all the things that were spoken by all the prophets will be restored. So if Elijah raised the dead, and if Elisha caused the axe head to swim, we're going to do miracles.
Yes, amen.
Because it's restoration time.
Yes,
if Moses opened the Red Sea, we're going to open rivers. We're going to come into situations that look so impossible to mankind. But we will be able to know it's restoration time, and we will speak a word. And we will see the hand of God in motion. What's going on? He got a revelation. What's the revelation? The revelation is when you get restoration, you don't need deliverance. The revelation is if you get restoration, you don't need deliverance. The revelation is if you get restoration, you don't need deliverance. Hallelujah. So what's the sign that restoration is coming? The church will laugh. And since 94, God is trying his best to get the church laughing. And people still walk out of meetings where they laugh, trying to put it on the devil. I tell you, the devil cannot make you laugh. The devil works together with country music. Yeah, if you don't understand, if you play country music backward, did you know what you get if you play country music backward? You get your house back, your wife back, your horse back. The devil's not a giver, he's a stealer.
Amen.
The devil's not a blesser, he's a curser.
Yeah.
This is a circle with your computer. Okay. John. Are you there, Joel chapter 1, verse 4? What the chewing locust left, the swarming locust has eaten. What the swarming locust left, the crawling locust has eaten. What the crawling locust left, the consuming locust. What a twist. What a shape. I mean, it's one thing. I mean, I got up, put the washing in the washing machine, and the washing machine didn't want to work. When I turned around to put the dish in the dishwasher, the dishwasher just said poop and he didn't want to go. So I decided I'm not going to work in the house today. I'm going to go do shopping. Halfway to Pick and Pay, I had a flat tire. And I got out of the car, and the man that came out of his driveway didn't see where he was going, and he ran smack bang into my car and took the whole bumper off. I tell you, it's just not my day. What the cankerworm has left, the caterpillar has destroyed. What the caterpillar has left, the locust has eaten. The locust have left, the palmer worm has eaten. My goodness. siniese pa van hulle vandag in hierdie kerk. En wat hulle gelos het, het die politieke partye kom opeet. Ek moet my hele bediening verander om op TV te preek. Besef julle? Kom. Verse 11. Be ashamed, you farmers, while you vine dressers, for the wheat and the barley, because the harvest of field has perished. The vine has dried up, the fig tree has withered, the pomegranate tree, the palm tree also, the apple tree and the trees of the field are withered. Surely joy has withered away from the sons of man. He's saying, because of this that is lost, that which is stolen, that which is taken away, that which is eaten up, you know what the sign is that destruction has taken place? No joy. Mark is a seer. Here and as a daran here. Draw my kruis na die Here se huis. Glo my kerk, maar dis harde werk om my te versterk. Vat 'n wonderwerk. Kan nie lach nie, get nie die krag nie. Kan nie lach nie, want die kerk sê ek mag nie. Dra my das saam met elke las. Collector sak, saam my nog knak. Ek het lekker geslaap toe die kansel praat. Nou is ek bly, nog 'n diens is verby. You're only proving that you're not living in restoration. You are proving that the devil has still got a hold on your life. Yes. Because the Bible says if these things are taken away, there's no joy. Yeah. But walk down the streets, everybody will wonder what you've been up to. But walk down the streets, nobody will think anything. They would just say, oh, must have had a bad day. Yeah. Now God's trying his best to restore us, to bring the sign of joy back into the church. And they'll send letters to you telling you how bad it is to laugh. My goodness. Can somebody not send us a letter telling us how good it is to laugh? Yeah. Proverbs says, laughter doeth good like medicine. Lach, sister. Dit verander jou lot. Did you know that when you laugh, it's the only thing that can happen to a human being that'll cause all your muscles to react? There's a book in the local library that you can go take out. The name of the book is Laughter Therapy, written by three medical doctors, not Christians, three medical doctors. For 20 years, they've been looking into this matter of laughter. Now they've got clinics in the United States where cancer patients can come, and they put them in this room with lovely furniture, not a hospital bed, and they show them funny movies. of Charlie Chaplin. And these Okies laugh themselves healthy. Chapter 2, verse 15. If you wonder what's happening, God is restoring His church. That's why the joy is coming back. So rejoice and be glad. Chapter 2, verse 15. Blow the trumpet in Zion. Consecrate a fast. Call a sacred assembly. Gather the people. Verse 18. Then the Lord will be zealous for His land and pity His people. The Lord will answer and say to His people, behold, I will send you grain and new wine and oil. Chapter 1 we read, no grain, no wine, no oil. Chapter 2, I will send you wine and grain and oil. Amen. 21. Fear not, O land. Be glad and rejoice.
Hallelujah.
Come on, people, read it in your translation in front of you. Fear not, be glad and rejoice, for the Lord has done marvelous things. Verse 23 says, be glad then, ye children of Zion, and rejoice in the Lord your God, for He has given you the former rain faithfully, and He will cause the rain to come down for you, the former rain and the latter rain in the first month. The threshing floor shall be full of wheat, the vat shall overflow with new wine and oil. So verse 25, so I will restore the years that the swarming locust is eaten, the crawling locust is eaten, the consuming locust is eaten, the chewing locust is eaten. Verse 28, and it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. I will restore the years that the canker worm, the palmer worm, the caterpillar has destroyed. I will pour out my spirit. Fear not, rejoice. Be glad. God is turning the captivity of His people, and He's filling our mouths with laughter, and we shall rejoice and be glad in the Lord, our God, our Maker. What's happening? God is bringing restoration. April 1978. I walked into a coffee bar, Christian coffee bar in Klaasdorp, called Living Waters Coffee Bar. They had a meeting with a colored preacher by the name of Andy Lamb. And he was preaching that night, prophesying and bringing healing and restoration to the sick. I was late, so I had to sit in the back. Right at the end of the meeting, he said, is there anybody else that I can minister to? And he looked straight at me and said, what about you, young man? And I stood up, and as I came walking to the front, he started prophesying as I walked down the aisle. He said, you shall be as a watered garden where waters fail not. He said, and the hand of the Lord shall be upon you, and he shall guide you continually and make fat your bones. And the Spirit of the Lord shall overlap and envelop thee. He said, and out of weakness thou shalt be made strong. And then you shall be as the watered garden where waters fail not. And then the hand of the Lord shall be upon you. And then you shall become great in the sight of many people. The Lord will use you, my brother. God bless you. That's the prophetic word. Written in the back of my Bible. Okay, listen. April 1998. Exact date, 20 years later. 20 years later. I walked into a church in this town. Special preacher was there. Called me out. Said, Kobus, come stand here. He said, you've been ridiculed. They've cast you out. You've been taken out of groups of Christians. Pastoral groups have chased you out of their midst. He said, but God is saying, and the years that the canker worm and the palmer worm and the caterpillar has destroyed, the Lord shall restore it. And then you shall be as a watered garden where waters fail not, and you shall become great in the sight of many people. This preacher stood up exactly 20 years later, day and date. He said, Kobus, the Lord would say unto you, you shall be as a watered garden where waters fail not, because God is restoring the years that the canker worm and the palmer worm and the caterpillar has destroyed. And God shall raise you up and shall use you, and you shall become great in the sight of many people. Now, it's true. But in 1989, my whole system collapsed. Because in 1978, I was young and strong. I didn't know weakness can come to you. But in 1998, my system collapsed and I lost 32 kilograms in just 1 month of time. I couldn't swallow. Everything in my body started malfunctioning and I just couldn't make it. 5-6 years later, I picked up a book by Yonggi Cho, Why the Righteous Suffer. And Yonggi Cho said, and while I was building this church, my system collapsed. And I lost 32 kilograms in just 1 month of time. And he said, night after night, I felt like I had a heart attack and I just couldn't make it. And I had all these promises, but God said, the years that the canker worm, the palmer worm, the caterpillar is destroyed, I will restore it and I will raise you up and make you great in the sight of many people. Is this possible? I said, and then I said, God, how long will I suffer? And God said, 10 years. And I closed the book. I said, sorry, I don't take this. I don't accept this. I don't want this. I'm not Yonggi Cho. I'm Kobus. Last year, December, 10 years were over. But from 1998 till 1999, 10 years. Every Sunday after I preached here, people got excited. The anointing was great. But when I finished here, they had to rush me home to put me on a drip. Up to, in Pretoria, 1 night, 7 drips in 1 night to just get my system going again. No exemptions. Sunday after Sunday. Wednesday after Wednesday. Sometimes 3 times a week, I had to get on a drip just to make it. But the Lord said, out of weakness you shall be made strong. And the years of the canker woman, the palm woman, the caterpillar is destroyed, I will raise it up again. So 1999 is gone, 10 years is gone. So I've got a prophetic word that was repeated 20 years apart from one another. So the year 2000 started. And I preached the message here, Old Year's Eve, this is the year of restoration. This is the year where God is going to raise us up. This is the year where God is going to give back what the devil has stolen, and I preach in that direction. Never even imagined what will happen. Up till 2 weeks ago, 13 crippled people have walked in these meetings. 10, 13. I don't know if you even count them. Go look at the videos, go look at the photos, how many people have thrown their crutches away on this piece of carpet here. How many of you were here last night when that man walked through the water? Stoop there and said, I can't even. What's wrong with me? I can't even. I just can't go on. We helped him into the water. You must go look at the TV. You'll see it on Friday night. And when he got into that water, I took him by the hand and started walking faster out of the water, and he walked perfectly over this carpet, came and sat down here, totally restored by the power of the Most High God. In this year, the deaf and dumb heard and talked. Blind eyes were opened. Deaf ears were unstopped. Stuttering people started speaking. HIV, there's the doctor certificates on the walls. I mean, God said, I will restore the years that the canker worm and the palmer worm and the caterpillar has destroyed. And I will raise you up and make you great in the sight of me. Are you now bragging on yourself? No, I'm bragging on a big and a mighty God. Hallelujah. Who's prepared to do for you tonight exceedingly, abundantly, amen, far above all that you can think or pray for? Can you stand up and say, Lord, I want my restoration? In the book of Acts, chapter 19, verse 11 and 12, it says, and God wrought special miracles by the hands of the apostle Paul, so that cloths and handkerchiefs that were on his body were laid on the sick. The sick were healed, and even the demons left the people. And tonight, as a point of contact and as a sign of a great and mighty God, I'm going to take these papers. And God is performing mighty miracles in this ministry through cloths and papers that we pray over. And even you watching by TV, you can contact the number there, and we'll send you a paper that I've prayed over with my hand drawn on it, or a piece of cloth that you can lay on sick people and they'll be healed. Don't get a fright if everybody starts laughing within the next minute or so. Okay. Close your eyes. Be in prayer. Not religious, just be in contact with God. Not in contact with religion.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, God.
Dink net vir 'n oomblik of twee. Wat is al van jou beroof? Just think for 1 minute or two what you've been robbed of through the years. In your health, in your marriage, in your finances, in your business. Just think for 1 minute or two. And if you can see anything that's been stolen, killed, or destroyed, God says, at least double. It's going to come back to you in these days of restoration. If you were an energetic person, just think what you're going to do if you're hyperactive. Holy Spirit, I pray right now in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, while the glory of God is hanging and hovering over these people, let there will be a release of God's Holy Ghost anointing, that miracles, signs, and wonders will break through in this place tonight. I pray that restoration will hit this place. I pray that restoration will hit our television audience. I pray that people looking by TV will feel the same power in their homes. And as we pray here, I want you in your house to stretch out your hand towards my hand. These people standing here, stretch out your hand. Those watching by television, put your hand out. And I say, in your house and these people standing in front here, let the restoration power that Jesus Christ came to this earth for, the Son of Man is come to seek and to save that which was lost. And God is in the restoration business, and you're going to have life and life more abundantly.
I want to see you. I want to.